Hello, this is Palico Padge, and welcome to another episode of Padge Plays YOLO Edition with the game Orion Trail. That's how I imagine it. A bit like Pigs in Space, if you remember the whole Muppet thing. But hey, I digress. This is made by a company, or developer, should I say, by the name of Schell Software. And it is a take on the age-old Oregon Trail game in itself. Now, I am going to admit something here. I have been a little naughty. Usually, when it comes to my Padge Plays series, I do like to play the games a few run-throughs, at the very least, just so I know what the hell I'm doing. I haven't had time with this game. I'm hoping to do it justice on a virgin playthrough. Worst case scenario, though, we will come and revisit this back once I've got more accustomed to it. But hey, it's content. You guys want content? We've got content. It's a Oregon Trail clone. I love Oregon Trail. I feel I don't need to practice this game. It's all there. It's all in my brain. I know what I'm doing. It's just a different setting. At least that's the theory. Let's crack on, shall we? So, we'll just go through the options simply because we have a how to play here. Now, I have read this, but there are a few interesting quirks about this game which aren't in your usual Oregon Trail style game. That was hard to say for some reason. I have no idea why. Let's have a quick gander. So the goal of the game is to explore the oddities of the Orion Trail and reach the next Galaxy 4 starbase. Click and drag the star map to move the camera. Can I do that? I can't do that. Click on the destination icon to learn more about it. So that's all that is. So you'll be picking where you want to go, which is fine. We're cool with that. At the start of the game, you'll draft a captain and three officers. Each person has a set of stats which increases your chances of success with different actions. In most cases, the sum of your stats is used. So picking people with high stats is obviously a good thing. And we have attack, tactics, diplomacy, science, and bravado. Bravado. When you make a decision, the probability drive will appear. This device displays all possible outcomes that could happen to you. Each stat point will convert failures into successes, and eventually successes are upgraded to critical successes. Sadly, critical failures can't be removed. So the better the stat, the better your chances, which makes sense. There are four resources on this. We have health, we have food, we have fuel, and we have the haul, which obviously, if your haul goes up, you're buggered. And as with most things, if you don't have enough of an option, then you won't be able to pick that on the choice box at the bottom. You also have redshirts to take on to expeditions is the word I'm looking for. And obviously, they don't matter too much. But again, whether you do a critical success or failure does affect on how bad that all turns out. And that's pretty much it. That's all they give you going in. So I figure we'll crack on and see what's going on. So let's play. Select a mission. Well, we've only got the one. Oh, we have different missions. Then this is something I could probably do a few episodes on, but hey-ho. A sister galaxy to our own, the Wilkie May. The Wilkie May is nearly identical. Efforts to explore this sector have been put off because it's really annoying to refer to it by name. Okay, that's a fair point. And we have to pick our capitan. So we're going for stats. I mean, for a captain, I suppose we should probably go for a sort of as round a character as we can. So we've got Mark Kesselton, which is, it's all right. I suppose I'd want defense a little bit more. Tactics, should I say. Tactics should be a little bit higher. We've got the Space King. He doesn't think too much of himself, does he? He's big on bravado and diplomacy. Or we've got Captain Flife, who is tactics and science. I think I want to go for Mark Kesselton. Noted for his calm and friendly demeanor, Captain Kesselton is renowned for his diplomatic skills, even in high-stakes situations. Easily approachable, he's received the coveted license to chill. And what's my name? My name is Padge. With an E. With an E. Captain Padge. So there we go. That's our first person picked. And then we've got to pick a first officer. So we can go for Lieutenant Taylor, which is more into tactics, diplomacy, and science. We have Brick M. Stonewood, who is attack and bravado, which is okay, I guess. Or we've got Yesayab Neyes, which is tactics and bravado. I mean, tactics would be good. We've got diplomacy. Science would be good too. Maybe we should go for Lieutenant Taylor. They are low stats. but they're well rounded out. I think we'll go for Lieutenant Taylor. Famed plasma ball player Tyler Vish Tyler Briggs broke the all-time... Oh, it's Tyler, not Taylor. My bad. The all-time scoring record in his rookie season. Then he shocked the universe when he gave up the sport to enlist in Galaxy Force. My kind of guy. Now, I have picked three names. And as always, I picked the last three comments I have on my channel. So the first one is going to be Lebowski. Good old Lebowski. There we go. He's in. Boom. Good luck, friend. We then have to pick our chief engineer, which you can choose from Krista Bergte, Jack O'Brien, or Percival Squiddlevoss. It's an interesting name. Again, we're just trying to make it as even Steven as we can. We could probably do with a bit more attack, he says, but no one's got attack stats here. So I suppose tactics and science would be all right. Do you have anyone with tactics and science? We have no one with tactics. In fact, we've only got one person with science, and that goes into diplomacy as well. I think I'd prefer Jack O'Brien on this one, in all fairness, just to get that science boost. The rest don't seem that interested. So, yeah, we'll go with Jack O'Brien. A good-humoured communications officer with a knack for bringing levity to tense situations. Lieutenant O'Brien's leadership can sometimes outshine the captains he serves under. And he's got a good sense of humour. So, with that being said, the next name is very fitting, and that would be Dogman 27 with an underscore, but we're not going to worry about that, just Dogman to his friends. And then last but by no means least, we have pick your communications officer, Lake Cubulus, Kyle Glore, or the Fixer. I'm just so aware of our attack being so low, and that scares me. So because of that, we can only choose Kyle Glore with his unnatural sweatiness, which is fine. I'm not going to judge anyone just by their sweatiness. Lieutenant Glore is an operations officer with an impressive amount of dangerous mission experience, considering such missions terrify him. He normally plays it cool, but occasionally lets out his trademark yelp. And what better person to yelp than Killer 403? Nobody does it better, at least after 403 attempts anyway. So there we go. Those are our people, and this is our map. And as you can see, there's quite a bit to go, actually. And what do we want for starting resources? We have 8 credits. Don't give you a lot, really. You know, when it comes to the Orion Trail, you get an awful lot more to choose from. But with that being said, let's go. Well, fuel is an important one, I suppose. So we'll go for 2 of those. Crew? How many crews do you get? Yep. 2 crew per credit. Food is important. And hull is 6. 7. So we got crew 24, food of 150, fuel of 500, hull of 7. I think we're going to need more food. I think that's the way I want to pan it out. Should I go for more food, more fuel? Fuel's quite a lot. 500 sounds... Well, it sounds like a lot. I don't know if it is a lot. I'll go with food. Hull, I'm not too fussed about. We're fairly high on diplomacy, science, and bravado. So I'm hoping that's enough to get us through this playthrough. Let's give it a launch, I guess. See how we get on. So where do we want to go to? We can go to a Class M star where the threat is quite low. An older star at the end of its lifespan. Or we can go to the Class X star, a green star, very unusual. Or unsure, as they say. I like the sound of that. That sounds interesting. I mean, I guess we can get food from the Class M star, or we can just roll the dice and see what happens. I dig it. We'll do that. So fuel goes down pretty quickly, as does food. A space vortex opens up in front of you. Your ship's sensors detect an unknown object is emerging from it, headed right your way. So, we can hit it with science. What are my orders? Whatever is coming bears close analysis. We can go to action. Battle stations, unknowns incoming. Or we can do bravado. I immediately fly into the vortex. So, this is going to cost us food and crew. That's hull. And that is, we don't know. So we'll get food off that, but we'll lose crew. That will something will happen, but we'll lose hull. that we don't know what goes on. I think we better do the science on it then. You have your science team at the ready to analyze whatever is coming your way. So we've got a chance of one critical success, one critical failure. Oh, there's a lot of failures there and only two successes. All right, engage. Oh, it goes up because of the science and we are good. Keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going. Stop. Oh, I don't understand why it suddenly sped up again, but I'm not going to argue. That's a success. Your science team waits patiently for the object to emerge and waits and waits and waits. Eventually, the science team falls asleep. Evidently, time passes differently in the vortex, but that's okay. They look tired anyway. So we got an extra science on that, I presume? Hooray, we did. And where to go to now? I don't know. It's anomaly detected. That must be halfway. So this time around, we can go to a Class X dwarf star, which looks like it might be good for food. A green star, theoretically these shouldn't exist. Or we can pass through the asteroid belt, a collection of space rocks and debris. Both have low threat, so I don't think we've got too much to worry about. Let's do, because we've got another green star coming up, I think. So let's do the asteroid belt, because I can't see another one of those at the moment. Oh dear. You've encountered a gravestone. Sensors indicate that there is some sort of floating memorial nearby. Your navigator asks if you want to make a short detour to check it out. Yeah, let's go and have a look. We'll pay our respects, why not? Lieutenant Homunculus Bean killed too many Kerbals. Well, that's nice. That is nice. Once you finish reading the gravestone, you brace yourself for something stupid and scary to happen, but nothing changes. A lone space tumbleweed drifts idly by. Good to note. Are we carrying on? We are. A most bizarre bazaar. Hungry and curious, you dock with a warp junction bazaar promising goods so foreign you'll swear they are theoretical. You approach a cart loaded with glowing vegetables, ready to get what you want. So we can examine the vegetables, which will get some food. We can propose a friendly cooking contest, which I presume would cancel out whatever food we get. Or we can ram our ship into the cart. let's go for science. Science appears to be a pretty important one this time around, so we'll go with that. These vegetables merit further investigation. You can sort your science team for a quick weight check, spot check, pressure rating, invasive x-ray, and particle count. You smile apologetically at the vendor while awaiting the results. So let's swap those X's into ticks and go. Luck be a lady tonight. You going to speed up again? Critical success. Boom. Incredible. These vegetables have uranium cores at their centers. You pay a paltry sum for these valuable veggies and order your crew to start eating. Soon your fuel gauge is full and there's a line to the bathroom. Boom. Nice. Good, good, good. So, we can actually skip a section here, which is pretty cool. What is it? It's the Green Nebula, you know. A rich emerald green nebula. Most other nebulae are envious. Green with envious, no doubt. And that's another green envious nebula thingy. So, I mean, experience appears to be good in this game because you have a chance of upping your stats. With that being said, I think we should probably hit both. But then again, it's going to be a fuel thing, I would thought. 1, 2, 3, nebula. 1, 2, 3, nebula. Or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So you're only saving one fuel, and we have just picked up a load of fuel. So we'll hit both. It's only a short trip. We'll be fine. Operation Innovation. Your manufacturing robot, MK421, has constructed an exact copy of herself. She informs you that she has lots of ideas and wants to make more friends. This makes you a little uneasy. Her green eyes blink at you, awaiting your orders. That's not good. That's like Skynet. What? Who's that guy in white down below? Who's him standing with his legs ajar, like he has a very large penis, and running off again? It's probably one of those games where it's best not to ask questions like that, so we'll just move on. We can offer full use of the lab. So we'll gain another droid, it would appear, but we'll lose someone. We can ask it to build a giant friend. Or we can draft a non-aggression pact. Let's draft a non-aggression pact. Our diplomacy is 5. We should be good. Perplexed, do you not trust me, Captain? You reassure MK that this is for her protection as much as your own. A horde of robot creations is a big responsibility. Teeth clenched, you hand her the pen to sign the agreement. And we get 5 on this, which is good, I like to think. Don't be a critical failure. That's all I ask. Another critical success. I'll take it. I will take it. Understanding, the captain is protecting the crew. MK421 signs your pact. In honor of your virtuous spirit, MK constructs shielding defense bots to better protect your special operations officer during away missions. Oh, well, look at you guys. Look at you guys. Dogman gets a leg up there, and so does Killer. Well done, boys. Keep it up. Keep it up. So crew is good. Food is good. We'll move on to the next one and hope we have as much fun this time around. Or not. You've encountered a gravestone. Let's go and have a look-see. Cameron and Razor's pale blue dot. Not all who wander are lost. For small creatures such as we, the vastness is only bearable through love. Hail, Sagan! All right. You hear a loud hum all around you, and suddenly everything made of metal begins flying towards the gravestone. Soon, the grave is covered with watches, belt buckles, and prestigious rewards, and you're forced to use extra fuel to escape. Bastards! Bastards. Well, there goes our little fuel uppity. Crisis surprise shootout. Oh, okay. You're being attacked by an unknown assailant. The warp drive is down, helm controls aren't responding, and they're ignoring any attempt of a communication. You're going to cheerfully report your weapons all work, though. What's the call, Captain? So we can risk crew or we can risk hull. Crew's pretty high. I think we should send a boarding party and take them out. You nod to your chief of security, who assembles the boarding party. Once ready, they board a shuttle and prepare to make the dangerous flight over to the attacking ship. Now, we only get a bonus of 2 here. This could be very bad. The odds are against us. Bugger. Our first failure. Alright. The shuttle leaves the ship and begins the arduous task of avoiding incoming weapons fire. Squirming shark rats! The shuttle's engine is hit. In a last-ditch effort, the pilot sets a collision course, destroying both ships. What a guy. What a guy. I'll take that. Could have been a lot worse. And that was it for that? Okay, alright, well, on to the next end. We're going to the Class X star. It's a green star, very unusual, you know. And down goes our fuel and food. Peace, love, and understanding. You're hailed by a plumped, cross-legged alien in a scruffy bathrobe, tube socks, and sandals. Namaste. I'm the doting Dalai, guru of goodwill. Evil abounds in the galaxy, so I'm bathing all passing ships in a ray of pure joy and love. Yeah, let's check it out. Our science is high. I'm not willing to risk crew. So let's launch a probe and see what the bloody hell's going on. As the rainbow wave comes undulating towards you, you'd rather know what you're dealing with here. The science team launches a probe into the rainbow wave. So the odds are with us. Let's not get a critical failure now, boys. Stop. Bastard. Alright. The ship's computers spit out pages and pages of digital hearts and won't stop. It floods the system like some groovy rainbow virus. The malfunction causes the ship to go temporarily off course and you spend extra fuel getting back on track. Bugger. That's a lot of fuel to lose. A lot of fuel to lose. And now we've got an anomaly. Anomaly. Good. Astronomical anomaly. We're getting some strange readings here. Let's go have a look, see here. Oh dear. While checking various ship statuses and systems, the database you are using crashes and displays an error that simply says snack overflow. Weirdly, when the database comes back online, you have more food than you remember. Nice. I'll take that. There's no need to put on the red lights for that. That's good. Red eyes. Your transporter engineer calls you over, concerned. The transporter has activated on its own, displaying a seemingly random coordinates. The engineer is convinced it's a virus, but you know a call to adventure when you see one. So we can send a team into the unknown, or we can not beam them down. You know what? I'm all for exploration. To boldly go where no YouTuber has gone before. Let's do it. Oh, but we have to send someone. So, Who wants to go? I guess we need to pick someone who's got a round set of stats. So with that being said, I'm sorry, killer, Mr. Sweat Profusely, but it's going to have to be you. Killer 403 grits their teeth, ready to face whatever random danger you're sending them to. Are you sure about this, Cap? The transporter engineer says, looking warily at the display. These readings are really strange. Yeah, send them out! Send them out. Killer 403 isn't going to get off that easily. It's time for adventure, dammit. You nod to the engineer, who sighs. The transporter fires up, atomizing the away team, and then you lose all contact with them. Oh. It's a sanity check. Moving on. Is that it? Is it over? Killer 403 stumbles forward, feeling disorientated. They've been dropped right back in the transporter room. The transporter engineer looks surprised to see them. Oh, I didn't know you were out, she grumbles. What? So, we can try to beam out again. We can get some food before trying again. Or we can forget the mission. Get some food before trying again. We got a lot of food. Take some food with you. Killer 403 contacts the captain to say they are feeling hungry after that transport attempt, and they are heading to the cafeteria to eat. The captain doesn't respond, but the away team is too hungry to care. Missing mess hall. Oh dear. Killer 403's team wanders around for a while, but when they reach where the cafeteria is supposed to be, they are greeted instead with a wall. They stare at it for a while just in case the cafeteria is hiding. Nope, not there. So we can bust through the wall, we can form squads and search a ship, or we can ask for directions. This is our ship, right? This is where we are, I believe. Oh, look at that. We have Sir Fluffy of TARDIS. That's a magnificent name. Magnificent name. I think we'll form squads and search the ship. You know, tactics and all that. It'll be much easier to find the cafeteria if the away team searches in smaller groups. The squad breaks up, each heading in a different direction. Oh, maybe this wasn't such a good idea. Oh, it's the amount of crew you send. Oh, that's good. That's more even. More even. Don't you dare. So we've lost a crew, I believe, on that. No, not Sir Fluffy. Is Sir Fluffy dead? Sir Fluffy of TARDIS says they found the cafeteria and is saving a table. Unfortunately, the cafeteria has a strict no table saving policy, punishable by death. Their noble sacrifice will be remembered. Oh, Sir Fluffy of TARDIS. You had the most ingenious name ever. And we've lost you. I'm upset. I am upset. We got a bit of food, though. Investigation verifies this isn't your ship, the Indestructible 2, but the Invulnerable 2, a forced galactic ship with a mirror from a mirror universe where everyone has red eyes. The away team huddles up and plans their next move. I mean, we can investigate the dimension. Why not? Everyone here has red eyes, but as far as Killer 403 knows, there is no provable connection between red eyes and evil plans. The team decides to go undercover to learn more about this world. If they've got red eyes and we've just got normal eyes, wouldn't we just stand out? As far as, you know, breaking down that theory is concerned. Dimensional investigation. Okay, so it's clear the away team needs to find a way to learn more specifics about this ship and its crew before taking action. But how should they go about doing that? So we can go undercover, we can study from a distance, or befriend the janitor. Let's go undercover. No, tactics didn't work out too well. Let's study from a distance. Getting involved directly with the activity on the ship can only dilute the information. It's better to take a scientific approach, observing and noting significant crew behaviour. Plus, Killer 403 is shy. Oh, Killer 403. You're so bashful. Let's engage. So we've got worse chances this time around. Looks like it's going to be a failure anyway. Yep. Oh dear. Log 5. Some of the team gave their lives today to find out what hairstyles are currently popular aboard the Invulnerable 2 and who is dating who. I should have told Carlton von Heffingen I liked them when I had the chance. Oh, killer. Who else have we lost? Is that it? Just the one? Oh, we lost Okam as well. Okam Aldanis is gone. Everyone on this ship, from crew to captain, is a mirror version of those Killer 403 knew aboard the Indestructible 2. While there is no evidence of evil plans, any opposite of their beloved captain has to be bad news. Of course, of course. Do we stop these doubles? We have the attack. We don't really have the crew now, though, do we? We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's do it. This corrupt captain, this twisted mirror of Killer 403's own beloved leader, must be stopped. The away team prepares for battle. It's time to find out what happens when the invulnerable meets the indestructible. If Killer 403 is going to stop the mirror captain, or Niger captain, or whatever, they're going to need to make their way to the bridge. That's a lot of ground to cover. How should they make the approach? So, it's either going to be sneaking through the vents or guns are blazing. I don't think it's going to matter either way. For the sake of it all being a bit meh so far, let's go guns are blazing. The UA team may be battered and bruised, but those who remain do so because they're survivors. Fully armed, Killer 403 is sure they can take on anything between here and the captain's chair. Look at all those critical failures. This could be terrible. This could be terrible. Come on. Come on. No, it's going to be a critical failure. Shit. Alright. Sorry, killer. Wow, the mirror crew is super beefy. Maybe they would be willing to share their workout regimen. But before Killer 403 can ask, a particularly large opponent lands a blow to the back of the officer's head. And he's lost one health. So he hasn't died. That's good. Oh, but he is captured. Okay. When everyone comes to, the away team finds themselves strapped down in the Invulnerable 2's medbay. The mirror version of your science officer looms over Killer 403, a sharp medical device in hand. So we can knock over some beakers, ask about the procedure, or fight back. Let's knock over some beakers. You know, if we're going to die, we might as well cause as much mess as we can. Killer 403 has no idea what the various jars around the room are for, but they can think of no better way to raise hell than breaking as many of them as possible. I'm with you on that, Killer 403. Godspeed, friend. I mean, the odds are still in our favour. Not with rolls like that, though. Just... oh, God, okay. All right, fine, fine. Whatever, whatever. The beakers were full of bees from Earth. Who keeps bees anymore, let alone in beakers? They swarm around the room, stinging everyone and everything. So we've lost another crew member, and we've lost another health. Robbie B's gone. Ugh. That was close. Having escaped the medbay, the away team now stands at the entrance of the bridge. Den of the Bizarro Captain. Killer 403 hesitates for a moment. This will surely be dangerous. Are they really prepared? You know what? We've got 1, 2, 3, 4 red shirts left. We have Killer 403 who's on his last legs. I think I'm going to get the hell out of here. I've learnt my lesson. This is not to be... This ship is not to be messed with. We need to skedaddle as best we can. You know what? Killer 403 has raised enough hell, and it's probably wise to stop while they're ahead. By entering the reverse of the coordinates they used to get here, your team's beams safely back to the Indestructible 2. Moving on, so we've got, well, we've gone back to the crew which we started with, and well, that I think will be sufficient for this episode. We're running at about right time. Killer's still alive, although he's a little bit more sweaty than usual, and we're in a pretty decent position, I like to think. Crew, food, fuel, and hull is doing okay, and I feel confident that we're at least going to get to the end of this, he says, but who knows? We'll just see how it pans out, I suppose. So thank you for watching. As always, a like is appreciated. And I'll catch you on the next one. Take it easy.